Please don't touch that dial, because coming up right now is part two of DVD Classics Corner on the Air's salute to the original The Journey to the Center of the Earth, with its top billed star, Pat Boone, and yours truly, Dick Dinman.
WMPG, Gorham, Portland.
Hi, Golden Age film fanatics, and welcome to DVD Classics Corner on the Air. My name is Dick Dinman, and our goal is to become your exclusive guide to the very best of the Golden Age classics coming out on DVD. We'll have reviews, breaking news of upcoming releases, plenty of surprise guests, and a special feature devoted to the great Golden Age film composers, which we call Cine Music. So let's turn on the marquee and lights, camera, action. It's time for Dick's Picks, in which I get to shine the spotlight on one of my Dick's Picks of the week. Twilight Time proudly announces their stunning limited edition Blu-ray release of Jules Verne's classic adventure tale that captured the imagination of cinema-goers as few films had done before. The one, the only, the original The Journey to the Center of the Earth. Braving exploding volcanoes, tumbling rock slides, and flesh-eating reptiles, James Mason co-stars along with song and screen icon Pat Boone in a phantasmagoric thrill ride of an adventure that's certain to keep you on the edge of your seat.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is James Mason. Come along with Pat Boone and me, Arlene Dahl, Diane Baker, and Gertrude the Duck, and discover sights and sounds and wonders no living man has ever witnessed before. Filmed in the incomparable magic of CinemaScope. We'll take our leave of civilization on the bleak, barren wastes of Iceland. Peer in awe at the bottomless crater of an uncharted volcano. Make the perilous descent into the unknown. You'll pioneer with us through countless miles of trackless labyrinths. Discover huge subterranean caverns never beheld by human eye. Become lost in the weird underground maze. You'll find yourself engulfed in grotesque, petrified jungles. Marvel at the fantastically beautiful quartz grotto. Tumble into cascading salt beds. Escape from hissing steam caves. Behold the staggering underground ocean. You'll encounter breathtaking dangers beyond belief here at the center of the Earth.
Twilight Time's The Journey to the Center of the Earth in the wonder of super high-def Blu-ray and the magic of 4.0 DTS HD sound is being released in a limited 3,000 units. Once they're gone, they are gone. And is available exclusively online at screenarchives.com. Even as we speak. Stay tuned for more Dick's Picks, coming up on DVD Classics Corner on the Air, very soon.
The I love more than the meadow so green and still, more than the mulberries on the hill.
And that, of course, is the unmistakably melodic voice of once-in-a-lifetime song and screen icon Pat Boone, who I'm honored to have as my guest as he shares the triumphs, trials, and tribulations of his starring role in The Journey to the Center of the Earth. From the New York Times Review on July 25th, 1957, when Bernadine, your first Fox film, was released, and I'm quoting here, "Move over, Elvis Presley, and welcome Pat Boone," his exact opposite. "In 20th Century Fox's Bernadine, meet a singing teenage idol, a sunny, clean-cut youth of manly mien and fine voice with a real screen future." What a send-off.
Yeah, you know, I'm not sure I ever saw it. If I did, I had forgotten it, but thank you for that. So I thought, well, that's, if I'm going to make movies, that's the kind of thing I should do. And so now here's this big science fiction picture, and it just didn't, it didn't appeal to me. Not that I wouldn't have liked to do it, but it just didn't seem what I was cut out to do. And so I was balking, and I said, you know, I want to do musicals. And the producers and Buddy Adler at the studio said, we'll put songs in it. There'll be music. And I said, but it's still science fiction. I had absolutely forgotten that Bing Crosby had done a Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court.
That's right.
Which was not science fiction, but fantasy for sure. And unlike anything that, I mean, for Bing Crosby to be in that kind of a film was a stretch, but of course it was wonderful. Well, anyway, they kept coming at me. I kept balking. They offered more money, and finally, this is something the public doesn't know, they offered me a piece of the film, which, you know, was not done, especially for young actors. It wasn't done for Elvis. And it had been done, I think, by then for William Holden, The Bridge Over the River Kwai.
Well, the very first such arrangement was Jimmy Stewart, who had been, you know, had been a star for 20 years. For a film called Winchester 73.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, an agent named Lou Wasserman set that up.
Ah.
Now, but usually this kind of arrangement went to veterans like William Holden and Stewart, who'd been in the business for decades. And here you are in your fourth film, and you're able to negotiate that.
Well,
that's extraordinary.
I didn't do it, of course, because I really didn't want to do it, the film. But my agent, GAC, General Artist, and management said to me, Pat, you can't turn this down. And now even I, at that stage, knew that the studios were famous for their creative accounting, and knowing that I might have a piece of the profits of the film might be meaningless, because the way they would do their booking, their bookkeeping and accounting, there might never be any profits that they registered.
Yes.
And so, but my management just felt so urgent. So I said, oh, okay. So I really kind of reluctantly agreed to do the film. But once, like anything else I did, if I agreed to do it, I was certainly going to do my very best. And I knew it would be a challenge. And so knowing I was playing a young Scottish lad, Alexander McEwen, And I'm a boy from Nashville, Tennessee.
I know.
And I'd heard the jokes about Tony Curtis playing Prince Valiant with a Brooklyn accent.
Well, that was Robert Wagner, actually.
Oh, Robert Wagner.
And he was outrageously miscast. But Tony Curtis also did a film called The Black Shield of Falworth.
Where he played a knight.
And all of these, I spoke to Tony about this, and all of these Arabian films, the most famous quote, "Yonder lies the castle of my father, the Caliph."
Well, see, I wanted to try to avoid that. So I got with a man named Alfred Dixon, a diction coach who had also helped Julie Andrews develop her Cockney accent, and was famous for helping actors and actresses to do the accents reliably that they were supposed to do. And certainly, British actors and actresses do American.
Mm-hmm.
So I spent about 3 weeks while I was still finishing up my television show, and I think maybe I graduated from Columbia by then, but I was still living in New York. So I went day after day, and I worked on a Scottish burr, so I could be Alexander McEwen from Edinburgh. And when I got to 20th and I began the filming, people were very impressed that I was, that I really sounded like a Scottish lad, at least to everybody on the set and the director. And about the fourth day, Buddy Adler called me into his office, head of the studio, said, "You're doing a fine job, young man, but let me request that you tone down your Scottish burr, because we can't understand a word you're saying in the dailies." And we're going to have to redub. We're going to have to dub those lines. So tone down the Scottish accent.
Well, Arlene Dahl told me that the same problem existed with her initially very, very heavy Swedish accent.
Mm-hmm.
And she claimed that a great deal in her memory of the film had to be redubbed.
Oh, yeah, it did. Yeah, because some of the things we were doing were noisy. And we filmed, as I say, down in Carlsbad Caverns, hundreds of feet below the below ground.
How long were you there?
I've lost track of the exact time, but I think we were there at least a week, filming at night, because the tourists took over the place in the daytime. So we had to reverse our sleeping schedules and shoot all night long, and of course I felt tired sometimes between scenes. It wasn't worth going back to the surface to get to a trailer, and I would lie down somewhere, because I had a lot of clothes on anyway, lie down and put something under my head and find a quiet nook back in the cave and take a nap while the others were shooting. One time I put my head under a little overhang, a rock overhang, and got out of anybody's way, and either they called me or something happened that startled me, and I raised up and hit my head.
Ooh.
On that craggy overhang.
Oh.
And I realized that what woke me up next to me was a big, as I remember it, very big albino rat.
Oh, no.
That was, you know, right close to my face.
Oh.
And I guess animals that lived down there, and they ate off the garbage that people threw, you know, when they were touring. But he'd never seen the light of day. and I had a big welt on my forehead that had to be compensated for with makeup. But I didn't lie down and take a nap after that anymore.
Oh, yeah, no, I would imagine not.
Now for station identification.
DVD Classics Corner on the Air is proud to be a presentation of Southern Maine's own WMPG FM, 90.9 and 104.1 on your dial. Now, you mentioned you had profit participation, which may, explain the credits, which say, I think, something like 20th Century Fox Production.
Yep.
In association with, yep, Cooga Mooga Productions.
You are right. Well,
now,
you're very observant. I don't know anybody's ever brought that up but you.
Well, Pat, I've got to ask you this. What in the name of whatever is a Cooga Mooga? Can I buy one? Can I date one? What is a Cooga Mooga?
Well, you know, this sounds so preposterous, but of course my quirky sense of humor so delighted in this. Back in in New York, doing my television show, I we had to have a name for our production company. I was in college at Columbia University. Shirley and I having a baby a year. I was having hit records. It was extremely busy time. And here I start. I'm the youngest guy ever to have his own network music television show. And so we're trying to come up with a good name for our production company, and they're thinking Boone Productions. I thought, no, I'm in college. That sounds so pretentious. And they come up with, you know, Paramount was taken, and Colossal didn't seem right. So I'd been listening to a DJ, a black DJ from Philadelphia, who had a rhythm and blues show on WOR radio in New York City. And he made up words, he rhymed things, and one of the phrases that he used all the time was, "Is it great, great, Googa Mooga? Yes, it's great." And I said, let's call our company Googa Mooga Productions. And they looked at me like I've just spoken in tongues or something. What do you mean? And I guess I explained it, but I said, I just want to have fun with the name. The name is meaningless. It doesn't mean anything to anybody watching the show. And I don't want to use my own name. In fact, I didn't believe at that point, being the youngest guy ever to have his own network show, that it would last, because that year was the year of 17 music variety shows. I was the youngest guy ever to have one, and I just thought, well, some of these shows are not going to last. We're all going to be vying for the same guests, and we were. And so I said, let's have fun. Well, I prevailed over the protest of more seasoned, older people. And so we called our production company Googa Mooga Productions. And so at the end of every half-hour TV show was that this has been a Googa Mooga production. And I even had fun, it's kind of a perverse fun, of the difficulty some of the over 100 people working for us at that time for the TV show all got paid with Googa Mooga checks, which they couldn't cash just anywhere. You know, you walk in and you try to get somebody other than your own bank to cash a check on some company called Googa Mooga, you may have difficulty. And the secretary's answering the phone, "Googa Mooga, good day," and sometimes be a click on the other end. It comes to the name of our film company. And I said, it's Googa Mooga Film Productions. And you can imagine the flack I got for that. But then the joy I felt when I finally was at the premiere, and you just mentioned it, that 20th Century Fox logo presentation is so impressive.
Mm.
It's so glorious and glamorous, you know.
Yeah.
The 20th Century Fox. And then it says, in the same golden florid letters, in association with Googa Mooga Film Productions, which did not last on the screen very long. They got it off as quick as they could. But, I mean, I was just having fun. So that Googa Mooga meant nothing. But, and I can't remember, there were, I think, a couple of other films that were Googa Mooga co-productions. But it was difficult. It was harder for 20th. And their executives to accept putting that on the screen than it was for me accepting the role to do it in the first place.
So was it the profit participation that finally convinced you to star in the film?
No, it wasn't. It was the urgency. It was the urgency of my manager and my agents when that came up. It you know, I could tell they were going to strangle me if I didn't accept it. And so it wasn't that I thought it was ever going to amount to anything. But I just thought, okay, if it's this important to you guys, okay, I'll do it. Well, of course, I've been very, very happy over the years, because even with their creative accounting, not only did it enter into profit early on, but then nobody had envisioned videotapes or DVDs or certainly something like Blu-ray, so they've long since been in profit, and I've been very, very grateful to have done the film. But so did they, because, and this is another behind the scenes story, but here's the scoop. I had turned down before this film a movie with Marilyn Monroe because 20th wanted that. They had Marilyn under contract. I had a 7-year multi-picture deal. I was one of the last to ever get that. And so they wanted to put me with Marilyn Monroe in a William Inge film.
Bus Stop.
No, not Bus Stop. No, it was a film, a story called Celebration.
Which was never. I guess it was, unless it became that Joanne Woodward film.
Yep, it was.
Oh.
It became a Joanne Woodward, Richard Beamer film.
I think it was called The Stripper.
Oh, the was it?
I think.
Well, it might have.
I could be wrong.
I was thinking, I think originally, when he wrote it, I think it was called Celebration. I'm not positive.
Yeah, it was never released as Celebration.
No, but I think it was in my mind that was what the original screenplay was called. Maybe not, because I think there was a Broadway play,
yes.
Celebration.
But yes.
Anyway,
So you turned down the...
I turned down the film with Marilyn Monroe because it was, I thought, an immoral story. It was a story of a beautiful but slightly over-the-hill, I felt, cabaret performer, possibly stripper, but coming back to a Midwestern town where she'd grown up to get her bearings and decide what she wanted to do. She had been disillusioned and disappointed. And there's a young guy in the town who just flips over her, and she's flattered and lonely, and so they have an affair. And then he wants to quit school. He's still in school. Get a job. He's going to support this older, beautiful woman that he's fantastically in love with. And she realizes that this can never last. And so she leaves and breaks his heart. And, you know, in classic filmdom style, you figure, well, he'll get over it like tea and sympathy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you talk about this in time, and you
be
will
kind, yeah.
Be kind. And it'll be a bittersweet memory that he will cherish, you know. And I said to the head of the studio, Buddy Adler, look, I would love to make a film with Miss Monroe, but I've got millions of young fans, teenagers, and this film says that you can have an affair like this and nobody really gets hurt. It's okay. He'll get over it. No harm, no foul. And I can't do it. And he said, this is medieval thinking. He said, you're an actor, and this is a film. And yes, you have young fans, but even they will understand that it was not necessarily approving. I said, boy, it sure looks like you're approving it to me.
Mm.
And I just can't do it, Mr. Adler. And he said, well, you know, we can suspend you.
Oh.
And if we suspend you, the television unions and music unions, they'll cooperate with us. This could be the end of your career. I said, well, I understand. And if that's the case, well, that'll have to be. I know you have to make your decisions based on your priorities, but I have to do the same. So I'm sorry. I just can't do it. So they were very upset. I mean, I sound like I'm a young prima donna, but I wasn't. Mm-hmm. I was just acting on conscience, and so they made the film with Joanne Woodward, Richard Beamer. It was a terrible flop, but they did get it done. Meanwhile, I went into Journey to the Center of the Earth, and here I was balking at doing a science fiction film. Well, an executive of the studio told me later that the film, Journey to the Center of the Earth, actually saved 20th Century Fox because they were snarled in the terrible overruns on the movie Cleopatra with Richard Burton and
Elizabeth Taylor.
And the bankers were appalled at the cost overruns, the countless days over schedule, because, you know, Burton and Taylor would just take off and go to Spain for a week and hold up filming. They were just totally enraptured with each other and nothing else mattered. And so the bankers, this executive told me, were about to close the studio down. And because they figured they were just throwing good money after bad. Well, the Journey to the Center of the Earth came out and immediately began to rack up big grosses.
Yes. In fact, it was Fox's biggest hit that year.
And that saved the studio.
Yeah.
So here my balking at doing the William Inge play with Marilyn Monroe turned out to have been a great thing, not just for me and my career, but for 20th Century Fox.
April love,
is for the very young. Every star's a wishing star that shines for you. April love is all the seven wonders. One little kiss can tell you this is true. Sometimes an April day will suddenly bring showers, rain to grow the flowers for her first bouquet.
Please join me next week for part three of my journey to the center of Pat Boone. Well, that's my show for today. DVD Classics Corner on the Air is conceived, written, produced, and directed by me, Double D. And if you missed any part of this show, or if you'd like to hear some of my other latest shows, just go to the archive section at www.wmpg.org. And if you'd like to hear some of my older, vintage shows, please go to www.dvdclassicscorner.net, where in addition to the broadcasts, you'll find hundreds of my print reviews of classic DVD releases. So, until next week on WMPG...
keep well, keep happy, and keep listening.